Okay, first, a couple of disclaimers. As some of you know, I'm a huge fan of Hank and John Green, makers of the Crash Course YouTube videos for biology, world history, and a ton of other subjects. We've watched a bunch of Crash Course videos in world history, but the U.S. world history course doesn't exactly line up with our curriculum, so I've been forced to concoct my own far less funny, far less original, far more low-budget, as in no-budget, summary of the events of the 20th century to help you review for this exam. Which brings me to my second disclaimer. This is not really a review of everything that happened in the 20th century, or even everything important that happened in the 20th century. As I said way back at the beginning of the course, if I were to make up a curriculum about what I thought was important in the 20th century, it would be a very different curriculum from the one we've studied. We might learn about the women's suffrage movement and the discovery of insulin and how Newfoundland joined Canada and Martin Luther King's I Have a Dream speech and lots of other cool stuff, which we didn't learn. This is essentially a review of some of the stuff you need to know for the World History 3201 Newfoundland Public Exam based on the provincial curriculum. And as I've also ranted before, the people who made up the provincial curriculum felt that mostly what you need to know about the 20th century is there was a lot of war. That partly helps explain why the period we're defining as the 20th century begins with one act of violence and ends with another. You might think it's pretty obvious that the 20th century started on January 1st, 1900 and ended on December 31st, 1999, a night when, by the way, I had a horrible flu and was unable to go to any of the end of the millennium celebrations down at the harbor front. But for the purposes of this course, we really count the 20th century as starting on June 28th, 1914 with the assassination of Archduke Franz Ferdinand in Sarajevo and ending on September 11th, 2001 with the attack on the World Trade Center in New York City. If we answer the question of why these two acts of violence and a bunch of others that happened in between are so significant, we will not have explored everything that matters about the 20th century, not by a long shot, but we will have understood a few important things about it and, what matters in the short term, you'll be a bit better prepared for that exam. I just don't want you to forget that the real story of history is much bigger than a bunch of battles and dictators with weird mustaches and beards. So, 1914. It's a time of tremendous energy, innovation, hope, and optimism. New technologies and new ideas are giving people hope that many age-old problems will be solved, and the new century is going to bring in a new era of peace and prosperity. The whole new technologies thing definitely worked out like crazy, but the hope for peace and optimism and all that was about to get a huge kick in the teeth. Because all the while the major powers of Europe were supposedly getting more peaceful and cooperative, they were actually engaging in arms races and making secret alliances behind each other's backs. A number of factors, including nationalism, which is basically the belief that my country is better than your country, economic rivalry, competition to see which nation is the richest, and the arms race, building up the military so my country can kick your country's butt, militarily speaking, and also a system of alliances, all contributed to the outbreak of the First World War. By 1914, you have the nations of Europe basically lined up into two armed camps. Germany has its allies, Austria, Hungary, and Italy, forming what we call the Triple Alliance, and France, which still has a big grudge against Germany from an earlier war, has its allies, Britain and Russia, basically surrounding Germany in what they call the Triple Entente, which actually means exactly the same thing as Triple Alliance, but in French. Meanwhile, Austria-Hungary has some issues of its own down in an area called the Balkans, where some people called Serbians, who are part of the Austro-Hungarian Empire but not too happy about it, kind of want to belong to the neighboring country of Serbia. A Serbian nationalist shoots the Archduke, who's heir to the throne of Austria-Hungary, while he's on a state visit to Sarajevo. This would be an isolated incident of nationalist violence if it weren't for that alliance system we were just talking about. Austria-Hungary declares war on tiny little Serbia, the Serbians call on their Russian allies for help, and then, like a big old domino effect, all the other nations of Europe get pulled into the conflict due to their alliances. So the First World War rages over Europe for the next 4 years, from 1914 to 1918, and includes trench warfare on the Western Front, which is bloody, muddy, totally unproductive, and involves horrific losses like those of the Newfoundland Regiment at Beaumont-Hamel, where I totally recommend that you stop for a visit to see the battle site if you're ever in France, just like I did. On the Eastern Front, Germany was kicking the stuffing out of Russia, and the Russians were dying in huge numbers and getting more and more pissed off with the whole war. I mean, those who weren't dead were pissed off, to the point that they overthrew their own government, more on that later, and pulled out of the war early, signing the Treaty of Brest-Litovsk, in which they admitted that they had totally lost to Germany. However, just as the Russians gave up on the war, the British and France got shiny, new, much better allies, the Americans. The U.S. rushed in to save the day, helped defeat Germany, and end the war by November 1918. Then all the winners got together in Paris for the Paris peace talks. They didn't bother inviting the losers, nor did they invite Russia, because Russia had been taken over by communists, and nobody wanted to hang out with communists, and came up with something called the Treaty of Versailles, which dictated the terms of Germany's surrender. The Treaty of Versailles was pretty hard on Germany, as it not only limited their military, demilitarized the Rhineland, and handed them a bill for billions of dollars in reparations payments to France and Belgium, it also included a little treat called the War Guilt Clause, in which Germany had to accept entire responsibility for starting the war. This made the Germans very upset and angry, mostly at Britain and France, who forced them to sign it, but also at their own government, which after the war was this democratic outfit called the Weimar Republic. Lots of Germans believed that if the Weimar leaders hadn't been weak and spineless, they would never have signed this treaty, and what Germany really needed was strong leadership. Someone like this guy. But more on him later. Haha, I said moron. First, let's zoom over to Russia to see what's happening there. Even before the war started, things were bad in Russia, with tremendous poverty both among the rural peasants and the urban factory workers. Meanwhile, the Tsar of Russia and all his nobles were living it up and being enormously wealthy. A lot of people were reading the works of a guy called Karl Marx, who said that this kind of inequity in society would never be fixed until all the workers rose up in a violent revolution, overthrew the wealthy, seized control of all resources, and distributed them fairly so that everyone could have enough to eat. Russia wasn't the only place in Europe where people were reading and talking about Marxist ideas, but it was the one place where people were desperate enough to actually try them out. During the First World War, things got worse and people got more and more angry with the Tsar because they felt he was a bad military leader, didn't care about the well-being of his people. And as a sort of a weird historical side note, they also felt that this bizarre character, a monk named Rasputin, who supposedly had power to work miracles, had way too much influence over the Tsar and Tsarina. Just one more evidence of how the Tsar was supposedly out of touch with his people. Note, Rasputin's penis will not be on the exam. So in February of 1917, or March, depending on which calendar you're using, the Russians had a different calendar for the rest of Europe at this time, revolutionaries forced the Tsar to abdicate, put him and his family under house arrest, and try to turn Russia into a democracy. Just a few months later, the Bolsheviks, or Russian communists, decided this wasn't enough of a revolution, so they overthrew the provisional government and declared Russia the world's first communist country. They executed the Tsar and his whole family, pulled Russia out of the war with Germany, and changed the country's name to the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics, or USSR. The new leader of the USSR was Lenin, who wanted to be a full-on communist, but realized that he had to fight for control of the country. Not everyone was down with the whole communist plan. And he also had to keep people from starving to death, so he introduced a new economic policy, which kind of brought back some elements of capitalism, like allowing people to own farms and businesses again. Then Lenin died and was succeeded by this guy, the most successful and long-lasting evil dictator of the 20th century, Joseph Stalin. Stalin was successful basically because he didn't mind that whole people starving to death thing, nor did he care how many people had to be killed or sent to labor camps in order to maintain his absolute dictatorial control over the country. His goal was to make the USSR into a great military and industrial power, and with the help of his five-year plans, he succeeded, and everyone was happy except for all the people who died under his regime, which were several million. The rest of Europe was completely freaked out by the idea of communist Russia because, of course, people in power like to hold on to power and avoid things like workers' revolutions. Remember that political spectrum? So just as communism is a political philosophy of the extreme left, fascism, which is a political philosophy on the far right, sprang up to give people an alternative. An alternative, that is, if you're looking for a completely different kind of harsh dictatorship to live under. Fascism was pretty much invented by Mussolini in Italy in the 1920s, and its key elements were extreme nationalism, fanatical devotion to a leader, the glorification of war and violence, and the offering of simple solutions to complex problems, often by identifying certain groups of people in society as scapegoats and blaming all society's problems on them. The ultimate fascist dictator was, of course, Adolf Hitler, who rose to power in Germany in the late 1920s and early 30s, eventually becoming chancellor in 1932. Hitler took a lot of Mussolini's ideas and applied them to the problems of Germany, where the war had left Germany with huge debts, hyperinflation, a crippled economy, and no trust in democracy. Hitler and the Nazi Party gained popularity by promising to make Germany strong and great again, and once they had gained enough seats in the Reichstag to have Hitler chosen as chancellor, they quickly moved to abolish other political parties, do away with any semblance of democracy, and crush the voices of dissent. Good times, good times. While all this was going on, Europe and North America were in the grip of a Great Depression, which was a huge economic slowdown which had been started by the collapse of the stock market in the U.S. Since everyone traded with the U.S. and everyone had borrowed money from the U.S., the collapse of their formerly booming economy led to hard times everywhere. Starvation in Russia, and in Germany, the very economic hardship that led people to think that putting the Nazis in power was a good idea. Once the Nazis were in power, they immediately started to ignore the Treaty of Versailles. Hitler began a big military buildup, and in 1936 he sent troops into the Rhineland, a part of Germany that was supposed to remain demilitarized under the terms of the treaty. Somewhat surprisingly, Britain and France did nothing to stop this move, so Hitler got bolder. Next, he annexed Austria, another thing he wasn't supposed to do. His next move was to try to take over Czechoslovakia. Britain and France, who had barely recovered from the last war and so wanted to avoid another one, were practicing something called the policy of appeasement, which is basically what you do if you're at the supermarket with a toddler and the toddler pitches a fit because he wants candy and you give him candy to shut him up. In this case, Hitler was the toddler and the candy was a strip of Czechoslovakia called the Sudetenland, which was full of German-speaking people, so why, Hitler argued, shouldn't it belong to Germany? At the Munich Conference, where Germany, Italy, France, and Britain sat down to decide what to do with Czechoslovakia, but didn't invite Czechoslovakia to the party, Hitler promised that if they let him take the Sudetenland, he would absolutely, positively not invade Czechoslovakia, and the leaders of France and Britain went home saying, "Hey, look, we cut a deal with Hitler, appeasement totally works." Of course, Hitler learned the same lesson as the toddler in the supermarket. Screaming get you what you want, and 6 months later, guess what? He invaded Czechoslovakia. So when Hitler's next target was obviously Poland, the British said, "Okay, this is where we draw the line. You absolutely cannot invade Poland, and if you do, we'll declare war." Which they did when Hitler totally did invade Poland in September of 1939. His amazing blitzkrieg tactics flattened Poland in like 3 weeks, and the British didn't actually have a chance to do anything to help the Poles, but World War II was so on. And on and on and on. At first, things went great for Nazi Germany as they conquered more and more territory, culminating in the fall of France after only 6 weeks of fighting in June of 1940. Then they bombed English cities for several months in the Battle of Britain, hoping to soften British defenses in preparation for an invasion by sea. When that didn't work, the Germans turned their attention towards Russia, and that's when things started going badly for them as they got trapped in the nasty Russian winter and began dying in large numbers. Meanwhile, on the other side of the world, the Japanese, who had an alliance with Germany, attacked the American Navy at Pearl Harbor, bringing the U.S. into the war. Once again, America saves the day! It took a little longer this time, like 3 more years from the time the U.S. entered the war till Hitler finally surrendered, but at last the war in Europe was over in May of 1945. In the aftermath of the war in Europe, the world discovered the horrific things that had been happening in the Nazi concentration camps, where 6 million Jews and many, many other people the Nazis disliked were brutally murdered. This hardly ever comes up on the exam, but you need to know it just to be counted as a human being, so I'm not going to totally skip over it. Of course, the war in the Pacific was still going on in the spring and summer of 1945, with the Japanese losing but refusing to surrender, because they're like that, and the Americans finally ended it all with a big bang by dropping the world's first atomic bomb on Hiroshima, and 3 days later dropping the world's second atomic bomb on Nagasaki, just in case the Japanese hadn't noticed the 80,000 people who died the first time. Not surprisingly, Japan surrendered unconditionally, and World War II was over. But the Cold War was just beginning. So throughout the war, Britain and the U.S. had been allied with the Soviet Union to fight Nazi Germany, but it wasn't really a close alliance. It was more the, let's team up together to fight this bully even though we hate each other and then we'll be free to fight each other kind of alliance. In the closing months of the war, the leaders of the three countries that were obviously going to win the war, Stalin, Roosevelt, and Churchill, met at Yalta to decide how Europe was going to be governed after the war. Stalin had this idea that all the countries of Eastern Europe, which his Red Army had freed from Nazi occupation, should get nice new communist governments so they would be friendly allies of the Soviet Union. The U.S. and Britain were, to put it mildly, not down with that idea. A few months later, after Germany had surrendered, the leaders of the U.S., Britain, and the Soviet Union met again at Potsdam. By this time, Roosevelt had inconveniently died and been replaced by Truman, and Churchill got voted out of office and replaced by Attlee. So Stalin was left as the senior experienced statement of the bunch, which may explain why he basically got everything he wanted out of the deal. Germany was split up into administrative zones, which eventually became the two separate countries of Communist East Germany and Democratic West Germany, and Stalin got the friendly, easily controlled communist governments he wanted in the other Eastern European countries. As the atomic bomb hit Hiroshima immediately after this conference, the other thing the Russians got was the clear message that the U.S. had amazing new weapons and was prepared to use them, which only increased the hostility between the U.S. and their allies and the USSR and their allies. Winston Churchill, who was now out of office so had lots of free time to travel around making speeches, made a famous speech in which he said that an iron curtain had fallen across Europe, but he didn't mean it literally. For the next several years, that not-literal Iron Curtain got more and more impenetrable as Eastern Europe grew ever closer to the USSR, and Western Europe, with the help of billions of dollars of American money and something called the Marshall Plan, grew even tighter with the U.S. The Soviets tried to flex their muscle by cutting West Berlin off from the rest of West Germany, and the U.S. and British flew supplies in to show the people of West Berlin that they were still loved and appreciated, all of which ended up with the East Germans eventually building, okay, not a literal Iron Curtain, but a literal wall that divided the city of Berlin in half, symbolizing this great divide between East and West. And look, here's me standing in front of a piece of the Berlin Wall. We call this time period, from 1945 to about 1990, the Cold War. Cold because the USSR and the US never actually declared war on each other, but both sides were at the head of rival military alliances and stockpiling all the nuclear weapons they could churn out, ready for war if it ever happened. Numerous conflicts did spring up during those years that were directly related to the Cold War tension, but you never had a point where the U.S. and Soviet troops were actually shooting at each other or bombing each other's cities. What you did get were things like the Korean conflict, where communist North Korea invaded democratic South Korea. The United Nations, which had just been formed in 1945 to promote world peace through collective security, voted to send in peacemakers, which were mostly American troops, to drive the communists out of South Korea, which they did. You also had the Cuban Missile Crisis, when the USSR and the U.S. came as close as they possibly could to war without actually shooting. The U.S. discovered that the new communist leader of Cuba, Fidel Castro, was allowing the Soviets to build missile bases in his country, which put them uncomfortably close to U.S. targets. There were a couple of tense days, about 13 of them to be exact, before the U.S. and the USSR finally cut a deal and agreed not to blow up the planet, which was a huge relief to everyone. Probably the worst disaster during the Cold War from a U.S. perspective was the Vietnam War, another America's attempts to pursue the policy of containment. Containment was the American attempt to stop the spread of communism around the world, which in general worked out about as well as trying to contain an outbreak of chickenpox in a kindergarten classroom. When the North Vietnamese communists started trying to bring down the South Vietnamese government from within by supporting a bunch of rebels called the Viet Cong, the U.S. sent in thousands of troops over a 10-year period in an ultimately failed attempt to prop up the weak and corrupt South Vietnamese regime. The war was extremely unpopular at home in the U.S. and ended with American defeat and a tarnished reputation for the U.S. in world affairs. Throughout the 1970s and 80s, U.S.-Soviet relations were sometimes more tense and sometimes less tense. But the Cold War didn't end until a guy called Mikhail Gorbachev came to power in the Soviet Union and said, "Hey, comrades, our economy is in toilet because we're spending everything on the military in a futile attempt to keep up this ridiculous arms race with the U.S." Gorbachev brought in three important reforms: unilateral disarmament, glasnost, which is political and social freedom or openness, and perestroika, or economic restructuring, which essentially brought back capitalism. All this resulted in Gorbachev's own fall from power, the defeat of the Soviet Communist Party, and the fall of communist governments all over Eastern Europe. This meant some good things, like you could now buy McDonald's hamburgers in Moscow and you wouldn't get thrown in jail for criticizing the government. In Germany, there was great rejoicing as East and West Germany were reunited and the Berlin Wall was torn down. It was like a gigantic world street party, and once again there was hope that maybe the human race could solve its problems and there would be a brighter tomorrow. But the end of the Cold War didn't usher in a new age of peace and happiness after all. The fall of communism brought some new freedoms, but lots of problems as well. For example, in Yugoslavia, which was still a communist country in 1987 when my bad hair and I visited the country and got thrown off a train in the middle of the night, but just a few years later had overthrown its communist government. Instead of a street party, they had one of the bloodiest civil wars of the 20th century as different ethnic and religious groups in the former Yugoslavia turned on each other and started fighting. Meanwhile, there's the rest of the world. As I've mentioned about 85 times, this course is incredibly Eurocentric, so it takes a real effort to remember that while Europe and the US were consumed by this whole Cold War thing, exciting things were happening in Africa and Asia too. The end of imperialism and the formation of independent countries led to huge change in Africa and brought to the forefront people like Gandhi, who helped move India towards independence by using the techniques of nonviolent resistance. It's all very exciting, and it's a total shame that you only have one 5-point question on the exam to talk about all this or about the violent and apparently unsolvable Middle East conflict between Israel and Palestine, who both want to own the same tiny but vitally important piece of real estate, even though all this stuff is probably far more relevant to the world you live in today than anything to do with Hitler or Stalin or the stuff that makes up the majority of your exam. So where does this leave us at the beginning of the 21st century? Well, the Cold War is over, mostly, and while there's still lots happening in Europe, it may not be as significant as events in other parts of the world. We're much more worried now about terrorist attacks like 9/11 than we are about old-style wars with two armies lining up on either side of the battlefield and shooting at each other. We're still not sure who has nuclear weapons, but we're pretty sure some of the people who have them can't be trusted. The UN is supposed to be promoting world peace, but after failed interventions in Yugoslavia, Somalia, Rwanda, some people are wondering if the UN is even still relevant as a force in world conflicts. And that Middle East region that we've hardly had any time to learn about is probably the most important region in the world today. The 9/11 terrorists were Islamic fundamentalists from that region, and directly or indirectly as a result of those attacks, the U.S. was involved for 12 years in a war in Afghanistan, where Canadian troops also fought and died, and also for many years in a war in Iraq. In theory, the U.S. has pulled its troops out of both countries, but with the rise of the terrorist group ISIS, the future is still very uncertain. Meanwhile, people around the world, from Cairo to Wall Street and everywhere in between, have discovered that taking to the streets in protest, sometimes nonviolent, sometimes violent, really can affect change. But after that, you still have the problem of deciding what your better world is going to look like. And that, students, is your challenge. You all missed most of the 20th century by being born inconveniently late, so all you can do is learn about it from books and write a kick-ass exam to show everything you've learned. But the 21st century, I can't tell you anything about that because it is all yours to live in, to influence, and to change. Good luck with that world history exam, but more importantly, good luck with what happens after that.